Hi, this is Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting video 5.6 for the Manual of Percutaneous Coronary Interventions. This video discusses how to approach resistance to advancing a wire or a catheter through radial access. Video 5.5 is a complementary video that discusses the same issues when using femoral access, but of course several of the issues are common for both access points. This video focuses on engagement, which is the fifth of the 14 steps of percutaneous coronary intervention, and specifically on steps 2 and 3 of engagement, which are getting the guide wire to the aortic root and advancing a catheter to the aortic root. Starting with resistance to guide wire, what to do? The key concept for both guide wire and catheter resistance is to never push hard. This is how complications happen. Instead, it is important to try to understand why there is resistance and then solve the problem by addressing the underlying issue. The first step to do that is to transduce the pressure from the sheath to ensure that there is no subintimal position of the sheath or the catheter and that there is no significant spasm when using radial access. If there is a good arterial waveform, the next step is to advance a catheter proximal to the point of resistance and perform angiography. Angiography can reveal the problem, which can be an occluded vessel that may require change in access point, or a significant lesion of the vessel that might require either crossing it with various guide wires and catheters or sometimes switching to a different access site. There can be tortuosity that can often be navigated. There can be wire entry into a side branch that should be appreciated with a wire withdrawn and redirected, or there could be an aneurysm that creates challenges to navigation through it. This is an example of radial access with difficulty advancing a guide wire through the radial artery. A catheter was advanced proximal to the point of resistance. Angiography was performed that reveals that the radial artery is of small caliber. A guide wire was easily advanced through the radial artery and the catheters were delivered. However, there was significant spasm of this small size radial artery, and as a result, change to femoral access was eventually required. Here is a patient who had bilateral brachial artery occlusion. In patients like this, femoral access needs to be used. This is an example of a high origin radial artery that was also small and diffusely diseased, creating resistance to catheter advancement. These are examples of radial loops that can often be navigated with various guide wires and catheters. And speaking of guide wires, there are various categories of 0.035 inch wires. There are the standard wires that have a J tip, and that is usually 3 millimeters, although there are radial specific ones with 1.5 millimeter tip. There are the non-jacketed soft wires, such as the Benson, Woolley, and Stork, that can navigate through tortuosity without injuring the vessel. There are also polymer jacketed wires, essentially the various types of glide wire, with the glide wire baby J being the most commonly used to radial access. It has a 1.5 millimeter radius. And finally, there are the support wires, which are actually further down for delivering catheters through resistance through the skin or iliac or subclavian tortuosity. This is an example of a radial loop that it was difficult to advance a wire through. Using a Benson wire that has a soft atraumatic tip, the loop could be negotiated following by advancement of the catheter. This is another example of difficulty advancing a catheter through the radial artery. There is a lot of tortuosity that is straightened from the catheter that can also cause an edge effect with dissection and or perforation. The solution here was to use an 014 guide wire. That wire had difficulty also getting through the area of tortuosity through the radial loop, but eventually with slow, careful manipulation, the guide wire did cross. And then eventually that straightens out the loop and facilitates subsequent catheter advancement. The catheter was advanced a little further up past that area of loop. However, there was still difficulty getting the wire up. The wire kept, the 014 wire kept on entering through a side branch. The solution to this now was different. A J-tipped wire was advanced, the J-tip prevented the wire from getting into the side branch, and then the catheter could be advanced further up into the brachial artery. Here's an example of difficulty getting through the subclavian. Sometimes the wire preferentially goes into the carotid, eventually with pulling back and redirecting and having the patient take a deep breath, entry of the wire into the ascending aorta was achieved. Going on to the next step, which is getting the catheter to the aortic root. The concept is very similar to the resistance to guide wire advancement. Never push hard to avoid complications. Instead, transduce the pressure from the sheath, advance the catheter, perform angiography, understand the underlying problem. If there is severe lesion or occlusion, access may need to be changed. Quite often, different wires and catheters can go through the severe lesion. If there's tortuosity, various wires and catheters or long sheaths can be used. And if there is spasm for radial access, vasodilators can be used. These are examples of severe radial spasm from Dr. Paisis. And there is actually a specific video, 5.9, that discusses treatment and prevention of spasm, which has vasodilators as the first step, good sedation, use of smaller catheters or dimple surface catheters, or sheathless guides in case of PCI. This is another example of a radial loop that is hard to negotiate. The catheter made it partially through the lesion. And then quite often, if there is persistence of the operator and slow advancement, the catheter would not go much further because of that radial or brachial loop. But eventually with a gentle rotation, the catheter and the wire eventually straighten the vessel. And after the vessel was straightened, then the catheter could be advanced without difficulty up into the aorta. Another way to facilitate advancement through tortuosity is to use the so-called balloon-assisted tracking or BAT technique. This technique prevents issues such as the catheter edge going through the wall of the vessel and causing injury and or perforation. The technique consists of putting a balloon halfway in and halfway out the guide catheter. It is then inflated at low pressure that makes it more flexible, or at a higher pressure that makes it more stiff, and then advanced through that area of tortuosity. The balloon prevents the edges of the catheter from catching into the vessel wall and facilitates delivery. This is an example for Mike Kutuzis. In a case of significant radial tortuosity, a balloon is inflated halfway in and halfway out the catheter, and then the assembly of the balloon and the guide catheter are advanced through the loop all the way up to the ascending aorta. And this is another example of subclavian tortuosity. Sometimes catheters and wires can go through subclavian tortuosity. However, manipulation then is extremely challenging because of the significant bends on the catheter. In cases like this, it may be best to change to the contralateral radial axis or to femoral axis. Advancing a wire and a catheter can cause complications such as dissection, perforation, and arrhythmias. That is why it is important to never push hard to prevent these complications. Arrhythmias can happen if the wire enters into the ventricle when advancing the wire or the catheter. And when that happens, the solution is to pull the wire back to prevent it from creating ventricular ectopy. So in summary, resistance to guide wire and catheter advancements can happen both from femoral and from radial axis. It is important to never push hard to prevent complications such as dissection and perforation. Instead, the pressure is transduced from the sheath to ensure that we're in the vessel and not in the subintimal space. And then angiography is performed to understand what is the cause of the resistance, and then trying to find ways to overcome that point of resistance. Thank you.